After I left PopTech, my LinkedIn profile exploded. Suddenly, we were on the map.
PopTech was like putting jet fuel into our organization. It launched us to orbits we weren't necessarily aiming to get to, and certainly not at the speed that we were able to.
Somebody from the PopTech audience came up to me after the presentation and said, "Hey, I don't know you, but I want to join your board of directors." And now Eric Bauer, the CFO from The Gap, is one of our founding board members.
PopTech's Social Innovation Program was a game changer. It launched at a time when everyone was looking for a clear definition of what social innovation was and the potential for it.
We took a look at designing a program focused on the needs of an emerging group of people that were primarily working in some of the hardest places on earth to work. It was focused on building skills like fundraising, communications, how do you scale your business, how do you create the right business model. These seem like no-brainer questions until you're in the trenches running an organization that's meeting the needs of thousands of people, and you might have a staff of three.
From the beginning, it felt a little bit like an idea that time had come. Like it felt like, of course we're doing this because we have to. We need to do everything we can to help these really remarkable change makers make more change more quickly.
When I was a fellow in 2009, we were supporting just about 200 health workers in one country, in Malawi. Fast forward to today, that network is 25,000 health workers, and collectively they care for more than 14 million people, about the same number of people as Kaiser does here in the US. That 100-fold expansion would not have been possible if we weren't doing this work alongside the PopTech community.
My involvement in the PopTech program was a catalyst for thinking bigger. When I participated in PopTech in 2012, I think our budget was around $300,000 for projects that actually weren't going anywhere. And now we just surpassed treating 500,000 patients, and our products are sold in 63 countries.
We have one metric that we use in participatory defense. We call it time saved. It's a play on the term time served, which is what the courts call time of incarceration. So what we do is we look at what was a family facing when they first came to us versus what they received after they worked the model. When we reviewed all our cases and we totaled the numbers, we had 1,862 years.
Fast forward since the introduction of PopTech into participatory defense, and we have over 7,000 years of time saved from incarceration.
Now those are years with parents in their children's lives, of young people going to college instead of prison, of generational cycles of suffering that have been eliminated, all from the power, will, and intellect of families.
When I describe who I am, where I work, and what we do, that language came from the week I had at PopTech. That wasn't an accident. It came from discussions with some of the leading innovators in the world.
If you could somehow build in an MBA boot camp for the social innovation space, you could really help them increase the trajectory of their ideas, their organizations, and their desires. And in fact, we have seen that happen.
The first thing we did was looked at what are the iconic programs and people in the social innovation space, like Bunker Roy. We talked with Kevin Starr from the Milago Foundation. We tapped into Paul Pollack, who is considered the godfather of the social innovation movement, because they actually knew what the needs were.
People talk about Xerox PARC, right? In those days when amazing things happen. And the PopTech Fellows program has that aura about it, that it is still a touchstone for people. It is still one of the best experiences they've ever had.
The thing that stands out in my mind about the Fellows program is what an incredibly tight and collaborative community it is.
The networks, the advisors, the problem solving.
Communications know-how, the digital savvy, the fundraising capacity, the partnership acumen.
The diversity of PopTech Fellows, the different settings, the different kinds of ideas, the different kinds of sectors represented.
The quality of ideas, the realistic measurement of outcomes, and the long-term systemic change that I think is what nothing has ever come close to delivering.
Maybe that's really what the magic is we're really there to help them to do what they already do, but just do it better.
There wasn't pound for pound another 5 days that I've ever spent since I've been doing this work that has been more helpful in expanding and making true what our vision is than the week I had at PopTech.
We've all grown and we've become established organizations and companies who are working with some of the best in the world now and partnered with each other.
When I trace the line back, it comes to relationships I made at PopTech or sessions we had in the Fellows program that really helped clarify my thinking. Couldn't put a price tag on how useful that's been to us in getting off the ground.
You can look back at the last 10 years and see the ways in which really remarkable innovators who are quite early stage got access to the nourishment that they needed to take an idea from an idea to something that actually starts to impact people's lives. The world owes a great debt of gratitude for PopTech for having played that role and been that escalator for the last 10 years.
For the PopTech Fellows program, the ultimate return on investment is really creating impact against some of the greatest challenges we're confronted with as a humankind. And when I think about the context of this program in the Silicon Valley mindset, you know, we're not here to create billion-dollar unicorns. We're here to create high-impact social change, meeting the needs of humanity unicorns. And we've done that for over a decade, and we're looking forward to the next chapter.
And our new world order is about to begin.